Welcome. Good evening. Welcome to the Women's National Republican Club, and welcome to the third annual New York Dinner of the Calvin Coolidge Presidential Foundation. I'm Matt Denhart. It's my privilege to serve as the executive director of the foundation, and we are so pleased that you're here tonight. As I said, this is our third annual dinner. We're here to honor one of America's greatest and most underrated presidents, but we're working hard to change that. Of course, the president we're here to honor is Calvin Coolidge. We have a wonderful dinner planned for you this evening. This dinner tonight is all about contests. It's also all about education, and of course, everything we do is all about President Coolidge. In a few moments, we'll salute the flag, and you'll hear from Amity Shlaes, our chairman, about a new undertaking, a major undertaking of the Coolidge Foundation. That is the Coolidge Scholars Program, a program that has us all very excited. It's our own version of the Rhodes Scholarship. After that, you'll serve as debate judges. I bet you didn't know that, that you would be judging debate tonight. Debate is one of our major projects at the foundation, and I'll explain your role here in just a moment. But tonight, we're joined by four members of USA Debate. USA Debate is the US national team that competes against other countries around the world. These are four of the very best debaters in the entire country. And since tonight we're talking about education, they'll be debating the Common Core. After the debate, we'll hear from a true American leader and a bold reformer, a hero of mine and so many of ours, Governor Mitch Daniels. And of course, the evening of contests will continue after dinner when we close the night by announcing the results of our final contest, or contest, I should say, our $20,000 Coolidge Prize for Journalism and our Calvin Prize for Vermont Youth. But before diving into it all, on behalf of our Board of Trustees, many of whom are joining us tonight, I'd like to welcome a few special guests. If we can hold our applause and perhaps just applaud at the end. Thank you for being here, Governor Daniels. Mr. Wendell Willkie will provide an introduction of the governor later this evening. We welcome the great-grandson of President Coolidge, Christopher Coolidge Jeter, and his father, Edward Jeter. An old friend of the Coolidge Foundation, Larry Kudlow, is here. You'll hear from him in a bit, and we welcome his wife, Judy, as well. Stuart McLaren is here tonight. Stuart is the president of the White House Historical Association. He's up from Washington, where the WHHA has led a tremendous charge this year to bring awareness of Coolidge and education about Coolidge to the whole country. He even got Racing Calvin into the Racing President series at the Washington Nationals. And you'll have an opportunity to purchase a Coolidge official White House ornament at the end of the evening if you'd like. We're also joined tonight by the National Notary Association. You probably recognize when you tried to sit down, you might have hit something. That is a wonderful, wonderful book that we hope that you will read and commit to memory. It's called Why Coolidge Matters, and it is produced and is a donation of the National Notary Association. We welcome Debbie and Milt Valera, who are here from the Notary Association tonight. I'd also like to welcome Adam Andrzejewski and his wife, Carrie. Adam leads Open the Books, which is a fantastic project that is doing work that Coolidge would approve, trying to bring better government transparency in spending in state houses and in Washington. And thank you from President Coolidge and from all of us, Adam. We're joined by several students and faculty from King's College, as well as some deans from King College. Thank you. And we're also joined, it's a real pleasure, by several of our partners in our debate program who helped make it possible. Ben Voth is here, up from Dallas, Nicole Wanzer-Serrano, Cindy Timmons, Brother John McGrory, Josiah Peterson, all help us run our program in the summer. And of course, our Coolidge and our Calvin Writing Prize finalists are here with their families tonight, and you'll get to meet them later. So now at this time, we have a wonderful group here to join us. We will be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by the Knickerbocker Grays. If you turn, you'll see them gathering in the back. I've already heard many inquisitive questions this evening. Who are the very fine dressed young people? And those are the Knickerbocker Grays. They are the oldest after-school program in the country. They were founded about the time that President Coolidge was just a youngster himself. So now at this time, I would like to invite the Knickerbocker Grays to present the colors. Post the colors. Thank you. If the Knickerbocker Grays would now please join me on stage, and they will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may now be seated. Now, if the Knickerbocker Grays will come up on stage, before we kick off this evening of contest, we're going to have a little bit of a few words of wisdom, a few very wonderful and apt Coolidge quotes, which the Knickerbocker Grays will now read. But I think I need one little prop, something for them to stand upon. Okay, please give your attention.
The nation which forgets its defenders will itself be forgotten.
Thank you.
People cannot look to legislation generally for success. Industry, thrift, and character are not confirmed by act or resolve. No person was ever honored for what they received. Honor has been the reward for what he gave.
The real heart of the American government depends on the heart of the people.
It is one of the glories of our country that we all have the privilege of being Americans. The Declaration of Independence is the product of the spiritual insight of the people. We live in an age of science and of abounding accumulation of material things. These did not create our Declaration. Our Declaration created them. The things of the Spirit come first. Unless we cling to that, all our material property, overwhelming though it may appear, will turn to a barren scepter in our grasp.
Patriotism is easy to understand in America. It means looking out for yourself by looking out for your country.
Thank you. How about a big hand of applause? Wonderful. Thank you again to the Knickerbocker Grays. And how about those Coolidge quotes? And now, a real highlight of the evening is the announcement of our Coolidge Scholars program. Please welcome the chairman of our board, the inspiration of our work, Amity Shlaes.
Stop me if you cannot hear me. Catherine, can you hear me? In the back. Ms. Bassett, Ms. Kate, okay, good. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Louder. Matt, is it okay? Wave your hand if you can't hear. Matt is our executive director, and he mentioned a night of contest, so it is my honor to announce our greatest contest, a contest that we are certain will affect not only Calvin Coolidge, but the country as well. This is the launch of the Coolidge Scholarship. This is a significant scholarship, significant doesn't even do it justice, of the scope of a Rhodes Scholarship or a Marshall awarded for merit. Not to attend an English university for graduate school, the Coolidge is rather for American college, so that winning American high schoolers can attend the school of their choice in the United States. It is a full ride scholarship. So I'll say that again in case you missed it. It is a full ride scholarship, the Coolidge, to any American college. It's a portable scholarship, as our trustee Jen Foster likes to say. It's like a voucher. Whatever college the person goes to, the young person will have a Coolidge and also be a Coolidge, representing the 30th president and his values at the college. What is the purpose? Why are we doing this? First of all, our charter says we should elevate the name and the values of Calvin Coolidge. This scholarship will elevate the name. The most efficient way, in fact, to get a name out there is a prestigious scholarship bearing a leader's name. I mentioned Rhodes. Look at what the Rhodes does for Cecil Rhodes, a far more controversial character than Calvin Coolidge. Our scholarship will achieve this elevation of the Coolidge name. Our Coolidge candidates, first through the Coolidge application process, we'll get to know the notch and the president when they write their essay about Coolidge values. They will get to know Coolidge better if they are a finalist, because they will definitely come to the notch to be interviewed by some of you. If they're lucky enough and meritorious enough to win, our winners spend summertime, a few weeks in the summer, at the Notch, maybe living in the little cabins, shepherding and teaching our debaters in our debate program, whether it's a debate about Social Security privatization or income sharing for college funding, which Governor Mitch Daniels has spoken about, or income inequality. Our Coolidge scholars will begin adult life, and this is very important, on an up. They will walk into lectures with a spring in their step, knowing they are Coolidges, and they will say, I am a Coolidge, and there'll be maybe a little weight to counter the spring, because being a Coolidge, it requires some responsibility, doesn't it? The second purpose of the scholarship is to elevate a value of Coolidge. That value is excellence, merit. Today in America, we have a great number of merit scholarships, in fact, at most universities, but those are scholarships for athletic merit. Scholarships for academic merit are scant, especially generous ones that are not specific to a school. Geeks may succeed in Silicon Valley. Eyeglasses like my own may be popular, but merit as a primary American goal is fading on the landscape of 17-year-olds. Our Coolidge scholarship is like a flare that goes up into the sky saying, remember, there is a place in the prize scape where academic merit ranks highest and where merit gets truly generous recognition. A third purpose is to elevate another value of Coolidge, competition. Coolidge saw the utility of instruction through competition, precisely what we do with debate. I'm going to read you a Coolidge quote, and forgive me if I don't have the accent right. There is nothing in the world gives me so much pleasure as to feel I have made a good speech. Nothing gives me more pain, he wrote in college, than to feel I have made a poor one. I think I just had a good speech. I must stand very well in the college now. My growth has been slow, but it has been substantial. The details. In a couple of weeks, the applications for the first pilot scholarships will open. Our website is coolidgescholars.org. We are happy to announce that we have received commitments for such scholarships. The donors don't like me to say their names too often, but Thomas and Alice Tisch, Richard Chilton, Jen Foster, John Childs, Anonymous gave two scholarships, and Thomas and Diane Smith. So that is with some applause. That makes six full ride scholarships, but I made an error. Actually, it's seven, because we were just joined by Ravenel and Beth Curry in supplying the seventh Coolidge scholarship. Tonight, afterwards, you may ask our staff about the scholarship, but I'll just say a few words more about the details. Our jury will be of the highest quality, nonpartisan. It will be led by Dr. Bruce Cole, the former chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities. Joining Dr. Cole will be Governor Daniels, Judge Edith Jones, some of you know her name, Governor Jim Douglas, Richard Chilton, who was the beginning, the impulse behind this project, Ambassador C. Boyden Gray, who has served five presidents and is our trustee. New trustees, by the way, have shown their confidence by joining our board. We have board members, new and old, helping us. Want to mention some new ones yet again. John Childs. Jen Foster. David Johnson. And Rebecca Mercer. Other board members present who made this night are Vice Chair Catherine Nelson. I think she's sitting with Chris Jeter. Milt Valera, who's here with his wife Debbie, also a supporter of ours. Roby Harrington. Chris Nunn and Heidi Eldred. It seems fortuitous, but almost all these people have some serious experience in education. What? Oh, I forgot one. Garland, who's here with his wife, Grayson. I'm sorry. Many of you are familiar with our debate program. The scholarship is an extension of that effort to open young minds to Coolidge and his values. Our new Coolidge scholarship will be a further goal, a final goal for the hundreds of debaters who pass through our programs. They will strive for it and after it. The scholarship will strengthen our debate program and our Coolidge network, what we already call the community of Coolidge. The great basis, though, of the community of Coolidge is you here tonight. You are our community. Those of you who have been up to the notch already feel that. Some of you have been here, several has been up to the notch several years, Peter and Jody Wood, for example, right in this room. We at the foundation don't have cruises. Coolidge is a landlocked president. He probably wouldn't approve of cruises. But our visitors have commented that coming to the notch with the scholars that we have is like a cruise or a retreat. And we want to mention that in June, we have a wonderful landlocked cruise at the Woodstock Inn, where we will bring high professors and figures from public life to teach kids and to speak to you when you come. So please join us for that. And yes, there is golf. Some of you, I'm going to close and just say, some of you were here 3 years ago. We were just starting with debate. In the past 3 years, we have demonstrated our competence that shows we are up to the scholarship task. Our board and our staff are ones in which you may place great faith. That is why tonight, in addition, we make an appeal to you. Please consider helping us, not by paying for programs, but by beginning to invest in us as an institution you trust. A pioneer donor will be remembered through all history. On your table are red envelopes. If you are moved tonight to help debate or our scholarships, we are ready to help you do that with the envelope. Thank you very, very much. We're quite excited tonight.
You'll get your food before too long, don't worry. Please do keep eating those salads. But I mentioned that you all have to help us tonight. You're gonna have to earn your dinner. That's because you're gonna have to help us judge debate. We please have quiet, we're gonna continue. Many of you have already been up to judge our program. Others of you will have the chance right now to judge debate. As I mentioned, we're joined by USA Debate. Tonight, they will debate the Common Core. In fact, their resolution is specifically, Please, quiet, this is important because I'm going to tell you what you're judging. Their resolution they'll be debating is resolved. This House supports the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. Again, resolved. This House supports the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. So, of course, this room probably has certain opinions on either side of that question. So the way you will judge debate is, in just a moment, the Knickerbocker Grays will be coming around with a top hat. And on one of the top hats, it'll say AF. That means the affirmative. If you think that you agree with that statement, this House supports the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. If you support the Common Core, you should take one of the two Coolidge coins, which were on your seat when you came in, and put it in the hat that says AF, a green sign that says AF. Now, if you don't agree, you'll put your coin in the hat that says neg. It'll be red letters, and it will say neg, okay? So the Knickerbocker Grays will be coming around in just a moment, and we can have a little bit of quiet while they're collecting those coins because we're gonna get our debaters up here right now. Now, make sure you're listening during this debate because when it ends, we'll have our hats come back around, and then we'll poll you again. You'll put your second coin in whichever hat you then, whichever side you think did a better job of swaying you. So if after our debate, your mind has changed, you can put your coin in a different hat. We can have a little bit of quiet. I think people might be having trouble understanding the directions if it's too loud. Okay? So please look for the hats coming around in just a moment. Now I'd like to introduce our debaters. Arguing in the affirmative. Quiet. Arguing in the affirmative. We have two West Coasters, Liz Yount of Harvard Westlake in California, and Mylon Emmertage of Campbell Hall High School, also in California. So we have a little East Coast, West Coast battle going on. In the affirmative will be our students from California, and arguing in the negative will be our two East Coasters. We have Julia Lauer of New York's own Bronx Science High School, and Amit Kukraja of Science High School in New Jersey. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome members of America's national debate team, Team USA.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the USA Debate Team and the National Speech and Debate Association, I thank you all for giving us the opportunity tonight to come and debate for you all. On Team Government, we come from Los Angeles, and Team Opposition and many of you in the room tonight are coming from the East Coast. Although we are separated by many miles, there is one characteristic that binds us all together. We value education. President Coolidge supported the Department of Education and supported systems that sought to create educational equality. Because we value education, not as a privilege granted to few, but as a right that should be available to all, we are proud to stand on the proposition side of today's debate, that this House supports the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. President Coolidge supported the principles of federalism in conjunction with education. He supported a government whose primary responsibility was expressing the national interest. This is a justification for federalist principles influencing the common curriculum. We need a tangible vision of what education looks like for each child in this nation. Common Core provides that tangible vision. Our first argument is that Common Core provides a common denominator for education. A wonderful part of our country is its increasing diversity. However, we need certain unifying characteristics in our classrooms, such as classic literature. The only institution that can honestly advocate for the national interest is the federal government, since states cannot assume to hold each other accountable. Key documents from our founding fathers and traditional literature provides a common ground for educational collaboration and understanding across our country. Common Core allows us to ensure schools preserve these classics. Former Secretary of Education William Bennett said that a common curriculum ensures we, quote, are preserving and emphasizing what's essential, the Bible, Shakespeare, the founding documents. Federal influence is essential. 50 states going in 50 different directions is an exercise in futility. There is rampant inconsistency in terms of the direction and standards between states. There is no metric to measure the success between states right now. In a state-based system absent of Common Core, there is no unified vision of education and no common denominator. Attempting to satisfy the needs of everyone results in meeting the needs of no one. President Coolidge would agree with us. He said that, quote, the doctrine of states' rights is not a privilege to continue in wrongdoing. The Common Core standards are not at all intrusive. They simply set some general guidelines within which the states can determine their own policy. The framework of Common Core guidelines within which the states can determine their own policy are important because they set a high bar for the states, which they can innovate on their own to meet up to these standards. Our second argument is that Common Core provides access to common opportunities. One barrier that we face in California is significant budget cuts that are disproportionately affecting schools with high percentages of minority populations. For example, in the Oakland Unified School District in California, due to lack of educational opportunities and budget cuts, only 54% of black students are actually graduating. This divide is due to these budget cuts because they are disproportionately affecting the schools with high minority populations. Less money in the schools results in less resources, and that results in disenchanted teachers. What's happening now is the schools are actually altering their curriculum and their standards to give off the impression that they're succeeding. Thus, they're shortchanging these minority students of the education that they need in order to be successful in their futures. Common Core sets a consistent national standard with which clear expectations with which all of these schools need to abide by. Schools can no longer shortchange these minority students and rob them of the education that they need to be successful in their futures. Because we firmly believe that education should not be reserved as a privilege for few, but a right that should be equally accessible for all, we are proud to stand on the proposition side of today's debate. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. Liz, I have a couple questions. In a world of learning differences, socioeconomic differences, how can one national standard deal with the material conditions that different students face on a daily basis?
Thank you for that question, Amit. Unfortunately, this is a common misunderstanding with Common Core. Common Core raises the expectation for these students and has absolutely nothing to do with the individual teaching practices that will be seen in the classrooms. Common Core provides the foundation, so whether students have certain learning disabilities or come from different socioeconomic backgrounds, Common Core provides a foundation and gives them the right to achieve a certain level of education.
All right, now another question. The federal government has a long history of creating unfunded mandates for states to follow. Isn't the Common Core just another one of these same mandates that states already have trouble paying for?
We grant that there are some problems with the current implementation of Common Core, but as President Coolidge indicated, we need a federal government that is going to create a clear and tangible vision of what it looks like for every child in this country to succeed, and we believe that Common Core does just that.
Thank you.
President Coolidge once said, "Perhaps one of the most important accomplishments of my administration was just minding my own business." That's exactly what the federal government has to do right now. The Common Core fails to address the grassroots of our education crisis, a comprehensive, diverse, and individualized approach to state education. Because we believe that the Common Core lacks common sense, we're proud to oppose the motion. This House supports the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. First, federalism is not the answer to our education concerns, because while it standardizes education, it overgeneralizes our diverse and unique populations. That's because it doesn't deal with the material conditions that states are uniquely able to deal with. Liz talks about educational unity, but you can't have unity among socioeconomically and racially diverse states. Poor localities with underperforming students know exactly what the problem is and how to fix it. And while Liz says that states have failed in the past, the answer to that is that yes, they have, because they've been held victim to a faulty system of standardized testing, the same system that we are proud to oppose right now. You can't expect a poor student learning at a third grade level to suddenly next year excel at learning at a sixth grade level. The proposition is trying to say that we're leaving no child behind, but what they're really saying is that no children are going to be moving forward. For our second major point, to centralize is to politicize. The federal education system can now push a liberal agenda through the Common Core education processes. According to the Homeschool Defense Association, a test 2 years ago asked students, fourth grade students, if they thought that the 2000 presidential election was fair. And in a math question, asked the students about racism in mortgage lending. I'm 8 years old. I'm trying to multiply 9 by 10, and I'm asked a question about mortgage lending. I didn't even know what mortgage lending was until I came up here for this debate. It doesn't matter who you have in office. It's not the federal government's right or responsibility to impose their own political agenda upon students. But for a second major argument, local control is key to handling local problems, and crucial to that aspect is parental involvement. Common Core uniquely hinders parents' ability to be involved in classroom discussions. Liz says that the Common Core is merely a vision of what education should look like, but she's misguided. In actuality, Common Core imposes or prescribes very cumbersome practices. So to all the parents in the room, I ask you if you know what the lattice method is. Because if you don't, then I'm just gonna give you an example of what I was learning in my New York City public school education. Instead of just using the traditional route of multiplying, you know, with a multiplication sign and a line, we had to use the lattice method, where you draw a box, you do the numbers on one side of the box, you draw some diagonals through each of the boxes, you multiply the components, and you add them down the diagonal. And whatever you get on the other side of the box, that's your product. When I asked my mom if she could help tutor me for this, she asked me why I was taking an architecture class when I was 8 years old. And that's the harsh reality of Common Core. You can't experiment with curricula nationally because one mistake then becomes a continental mistake. You're amplifying the negative mistakes, the negative consequences 50-fold. But beyond that, we have to focus on special needs students. States in the status quo have ways of tailoring the special needs to students. They can reform standardized testing processes to make sure that they adapt to students with autism or dyslexia, and they make sure that their scores aren't counted in a national average. Under the Common Core, a student with autism is going to be forced to take the same test that I am, and their score is going to be counted towards our national average. In what world does the proposition see that as an equal playing field? In summation, Common Core might have good intentions, but its vision is separated from its implementation and its practicality. Because we firmly believe that the Common Core lacks common sense, we oppose this motion and we beg you to do the same.
Okay. Julia, I have a couple questions for you. Firstly,
President Coolidge was a conservative individual who valued local control, yet he still believed in a Department of Education. Doesn't this demonstrate that the federal government ought to have some hand in crafting a vision for education in the United States?
Amit, I see where you're coming from, but you're misguided. President Coolidge believed that education should be nationally recognized as a federal issue, not that we should have a national standard for education. Had President Coolidge seen what was going on right now, he would have been appalled at the everyday intrusion into classrooms. Common Core isn't just saying that students should learn to subtract in the second grade. It's saying that they should learn to subtract in a very specific, definite set of ways, ways that he would have firmly stood against.
Okay. But you emphasize the importance of states having local control in order to tailor their curriculum. But if this is the case, why haven't we seen more success at the state level in the past?
The assumption that standardized testing is the way to measure educational progress is a flawed one. The way that we measure state success in the past is through a system of standardized testing. But in the process, we fail to ask ourselves whether there's a problem with standardized testing in and of itself. That's an entirely separate debate for an entirely separate time, but it might explain why there are some disparities with state achievements, or why they might have gone misrepresented or underrepresented.
Good evening. America is a nation in which all students should be able to get access to the same education. However, America is also a nation that prides itself on the diversity of its people. Common Core creates a standard to be universally applied to students with unique experiences rather than letting local communities deal with those unique experiences. Because we believe Common Core simply lacks common sense, we oppose the federal government influencing curriculum through the Common Core. Now, Liz came up here today and quoted President Coolidge, who wanted local control with a national standard. However, President Coolidge believed that education was able to change lives, not that education was supposed to be dictated by one national standard to control lives. Let's go to side government's first point. Their argument is that Common Core creates a vision of equal access. It seems like side government is stuck within a fantasy world. A vision of equality sounds beautiful, but if that vision has implementation that has failed with the Common Core, then that vision means nothing. We can always say we want equality, but if that equality comes at the cost of being unjust, then the validity of that equality should be questioned. Now, their second point was that Common Core is one vision, but states have their own way to meet it, i.e., we give you a national standard, but your own states have tailored policies to meet that standard. This does not answer the fact that states still have to live up to that one national standard. There's a common denominator to meet, and side government wants you to believe that states have their own local control. But if that local control is manipulated by one national standard, then that's not freedom at all. How are we allowing states to have their own policies to help students with different needs when these policies must be tailored to meet one national standard? That is not state freedom. That is federal tyranny. Also, the reason states have not done up to par and have historically failed in the past is because standardized testing factors in tests from students who don't have tests adjusted to their special needs. Julia told you that Common Core uses test scores and national averages from students who have learning differences. Obviously, these test scores are not going to be good or are going to be diminished, especially when students who face unique learning differences are expected to take tests that other students have to take as well. This assumption that standardized tests must be the end-all be-all to determine what success is must be challenged. Common Core reifies these notions and forecloses our ability to question the validity of if these standards actually determine student success. Now let's go back to our points. Our first main argument was that federalism is simply too generalizing. It ignores material conditions that different students have to face because of different cultural, learning differences, or socioeconomic backgrounds. And our second main argument was that it pushes politics. Education is the place to learn about politics, not to have specific political ideologies enforced upon you. Now, our last main argument was that local control is key. Communities should be able to teach methods tailored to their own students within their communities. For example, the lattice method may be good for visual learners, but it's not going to be good for other learners who don't want that visual learning. Common Core uses one national standard to force upon all different individuals who simply cannot meet these standards because they have specific differences that are not held accountable for. We believe on side opposition that Common Core simply lacks common sense. And we reject federal intrusion within the realm of education. We beg you to do the same. Thank you.
I stand before you today proud of the fact that our country, the United States, is touted as the land of opportunity. But ladies and gentlemen, let's remember one thing, that this opportunity stems first and foremost from our education. And when in my state of California, a minority student has roughly a 50% chance of graduating high school, it's clear this opportunity has been eroded and something needs to be done. That's why, under side proposition, we come to you and say that we value education not as a privilege given to a few, but rather as a right given to all. And it's with that in mind that I'm going to be asking two key questions about today's debate. Firstly, is the federal government more suited to determine the national interest in education, or does that fall to the states? And secondly, which side is being more idealistic in this debate, and which side is being more realistic? But let's begin with the national interest. Let's start by engaging with side opposition on their highest ground. They tell us that the Common Core overgeneralizes people and overgeneralizes and simplifies the population. They cite an example of a third grader who's suddenly going to have to start learning at a sixth grade level. But we would question why these students are learning at a third grade level in the first place. It's because in the status quo, states lower their standards and force their children to learn at less adept levels, forcing them to learn at a lower standard. This shows us that it's because of state-run control that these students would have to jump their performance so much. This isn't the fault of the Common Core. By establishing a common denominator through the Common Core, we establish a baseline that states can then jump up to and innovate to. Secondly, we would say that we need a common denominator in the United States to unify our culture. Again, we echo the sentiment that we are proud of our diversity and our multiculturalism, but we still need unifying trends to keep everyone together. We see these trends in our classic texts, in Shakespeare, the Bible, even classic documents from our founding fathers, like the Declaration of Independence. Only with this foundational base of a common unifying trend can we actually have unity in our increasingly diverse society today. But finally, we would say on this issue that under the framework of the Common Core, states can still implement what policies they want. Julia told you that we would be disadvantaging special needs students under our side of the house, but we would contend that teachers aren't prevented from actually helping special needs students under the Common Core. They're still allowed to teach their curriculum in any way they want, they just have to meet up to a national standard. What we would say is that this actually benefits students with special needs, because now we're raising the bar, and teachers are allowed to innovate under that bar to meet it in any way they see fit. But next, I would like to ask which side is being more idealistic in this debate, and which side is being more realistic. Firstly, the thesis of side opposition's entire case is that we ought to tailor policies at the state level to benefit everyone. But firstly, we would say that this has been empirically denied in the past. Look at the state of education in our country today. Look at what state-run education has given us. It's not a pretty picture, and it shows us that in the past, state-run education has failed. But secondly, we would say that trying to meet everyone's needs dooms us to meeting no one's needs. And it's with that in mind that we ought to establish a common standard for everyone to benefit. Finally, we would turn to President Coolidge, who tells us that we cannot do everything at once, but we ought to do something at once. And it's with that in mind that we ought to establish a common standard that everyone, or at least a large majority of people, can live up to. Look at the status quo today. We have a problem. Our education system is satisfactory at best. But remember, America was founded upon the principle that we don't settle for anything less than the best. And it's in pursuing the best that we are so proud to propose the Common Core and that we are so proud to propose today's motion. Thank you all for allowing us to share a little bit of what we do with you. On behalf of the National Speech and Debate Association and USA Debate, to echo the words of President Coolidge, I hope we were able to provide you with some great speeches today.
Thank you. Now your judging duties are halfway over. Our entrees will be coming around now. I know that all of you are probably growing very hungry, but also the hats will be coming around while you're eating. So while you're eating, remember to keep in mind, if you feel more swayed after that debate, towards the affirmative, the side supporting the Common Core, you'll put your coin in that hat, the hat that says F. If you feel the other way, you'll put your coin in the negative. So now please, please enjoy your meal, and when we return, we'll hear from Governor Daniels. Thank you. We're very pleased that that Governor Daniels is joined us from Indiana this evening, and to introduce him is a friend and who bears the name that's well known in history and very fitting for a dinner about presidents. Please welcome Wendell Willkie II.
Matthew, thanks very much. It's great to be here. And my charge is and it's a real privilege, is to introduce Mitch Daniels. But first I want to say a word about Amity, because frankly, Amity's probably a driving consideration for most of us being here. And Amity is a unique force of nature. And I just want to take, right? And to recognize the very important work that Amity has been about in the tremendous biography of Calvin Coolidge, and also her previous work, The Forgotten Man, and really taking on a lot of the liberal shibboleths or myths or, you know, prevailing ideas which have governed American education about the history of the 20th century, and she has very much been swimming against the tide, and her works have been tremendously recognized. And as we all know, history is critically important. And so I just want to take note of the tremendous contribution that Amity has made, and now the leadership that she's providing to the foundation and the initiation of these scholarships is so important. It is a daunting task to introduce Mitch Daniels briefly, because his track record in public service is lengthy and extraordinary. And then, as I was thinking about what to say about Mitch, and I'm not going to review his bio, it's in this great publication that we had at our table, but in a nutshell, if you were to pick one public servant who best exemplifies the traits that we most associate with Calvin Coolidge, the one public servant today who best demonstrates those traits and those distinctive qualities, it would be Mitch Daniels. You know, we know in the last several years we've had a number of very distinguished Republican governors of important states, but everybody knows that Mitch's track record is equal to, I mean, is not, no one's track record as a governor is greater than Mitch's. I mean, his track record of accomplishment in addressing the fiscal challenges of the state, in introducing comprehensive education reform, so terribly important, as was addressed by our debaters this evening, in making Indiana a much more business-friendly climate, in really taking on the public sector unions, perhaps not as dramatically as had to be the case under the great leadership of Scott Walker, but the changes were no less profound in Indiana. And, you know, not content with a tremendous track record as governor of Indiana for 8 years, he has doubled down and taken on leadership as president of Purdue University. And to think of, you know, we all live, as many of us as parents and others as students, know that you see year over year increases in college tuition well beyond the rate of inflation, so that the cost of a college education has really become an extraordinary burden for so many American families. He froze tuition at Purdue, and he has been very much committed to ensuring that The education product is one that the university is accountable for, that there are demonstrable results, that there are opportunities for people to invest in a young person's education, and he's there on the front lines with the kids. As much as Purdue is a great university committed to STEM, you know, science, technology, engineering, and math, a research university, he's also committed to the humanities and is teaching a class about First World War to undergraduates, and he's a well-known figure on the campus. So that, I mean, represents extraordinary leadership. And I think, you know, when I think of what Mitch has done and then comparing him to Calvin Coolidge, what you see here is an individual with intellect, extraordinary integrity, character, principle, resolve, but also pragmatism and a commitment to get the job done. So without further ado, it's a great privilege to introduce to you Mitch Daniels.
What's the matter, Mr. Chairman? You didn't think I was going to be affirmative enough up here? It's my hope to be. I am so thrilled to be here. So many old friends. It's been like an old home week, old friends and heroes, you know, Terrell and Fund and Malpass and Kudlow and many, many others. Great fellowship already, and I hope not to spoil it by anything I'm about to say. It was great to see Tyrrell again. We got up here and he said, can I go get you a drink? I said, yeah, I'll have a beer. He came back and I said, Bob, aren't you having anything? He said, no, I quit. He said, it was making my friends too argumentative. Like so many of you, I'm here in large part because of Amity. Couldn't say no. I'm the chairman of the Midwest Shlaes fan club, and I'll have membership cards available for anybody from our part of the country. But I've devoured her written work, admired her activity in particular in this endeavor, and look forward so very, very much to the launch and the long, long tenure of the Coolidge Scholars program. I will simply point out that with Purdue University now in the third year of what will be at least a four-year freeze on tuition, if you'll send those kids to Purdue, you could send two or three for the price of one, Amity. So, there is. I Wendell went way too far. I'm no Coolidge. There was only one. But I have to say that now and then over time, before tonight, that people have drawn, there are some parallels and people have drawn some conclusion, some comparisons, I should say. Somewhere along the line, in family lore and later in my one experience in elected office and in business, I acquired a reputation for, shall we say, thrift. My wife has a different word for it, but gets at the same notion. Tom Easton came up to me also during the fellowship hour and reminded me that we had met once back along the line. I said, well, how nice of you to recall. He said, I can forget a face, but I never forget a suit. So, I usually blame it on my father. Now, my father was cheap. And I reminisce that, you know, I, like a lot of teenage boys back in the 60s, I got a job or two, saved up a little money, and I went and said, Dad, you know, I was thinking that money I made from the summer job, how about, is it okay if I buy a car? My dad said, nah, I don't know. He said, listen, I'll tell you what. He said, you study hard, read the Bible every night, get a haircut, and we'll talk about it. So 6 weeks later, I came back with my report card. Look, Dad, straight A's. I've been reading the Bible every night. And he said, yeah, well, you didn't, what about the haircut? I said, oh, Dad, you know, listen, it's right here in the Bible. Samson had long hair. Moses had long hair. Jesus had long hair. My father said, yeah, did you notice they walked everywhere they went, too, so. Here's a little parallel, though, that's a little eerie. It didn't dawn on me till I was thinking ahead to tonight. And I was leafing back through Amity's fabulous biography. Like President Coolidge, I was invited and inducted into the Phi Gamma Delta fraternity very late in the game. Now, President Coolidge wasn't asked as a freshman or a sophomore, I think, until he was a senior. He was finally asked, and it became a very important part of his life. Well, here's just a little story. I went to a school that didn't have Greek fraternities. We had sort of a local equivalent, but no Greek fraternities. If I had gone to a Greek school, I almost certainly would have had to be a Phi Gam, a Fiji, as they say, because my dad was. He was first in a family to go to college, sort of thing. College meant a lot to him, little school, little tiny school in Pennsylvania. He talked about his fraternity a lot. And 6 months into this job, two trustees of our school said they wanted to see me, including the chairman of the board, came around, and it turned out it wasn't any university business. They were on behalf of Phi Gamma Delta fraternity. Both of them were alums. And they said, under our bylaws, any chapter, by unanimous secret vote of the members, can offer membership, full membership, to someone who's no longer in school. And the local chapter wants you to be to join. And I thought about it overnight and decided, you know, people would understand. I can't play favorites, but I thought, because of my father, people would understand. And they said, now you understand, you'll be a full member. You'll go through the same initiation that all the rest of it. I said, you're going to take me out to Fowler and dump me without my clothes? And they said, no, not that part. But in fact, you permit a little personal touch, two nights before I got a crackpot idea, I called my sister, who has my parents' effects, and said, this is probably a dead end. I said, but Deb, go look and see if by chance in Dad's stuff there's a triangular purple pin. And there was, and I was inducted into Phi Gamma Delta fraternity with the same pin my dad was at Allegheny College in 1941. So maybe that's a little bit of a sign, but much more meaningful, if there are any parallels, and I wouldn't overstate this, but I do believe that when the opportunity came to some of us to do some things we thought were important to the future of our one state, that I'd like to think that we conducted ourselves in a way that President Coolidge would have approved of. I turned the state around fiscally, I think it's fair to say. We left it with $2 billion in the bank and the first AAA credit rating it ever had. It was broke when we got there. We left it with, the fewest state employees per capita of any state in the country. We left it with a law that says that when the state's reserves exceed a certain specified level, the excess is automatically refunded to taxpayers per capita. I used to say, maybe Cal would have approved. I remember saying, better to leave those dollars in the pockets of the people who earned them than let them burn a hole in the pocket of government. And I can recall his name coming up one time. I made the offhand remark in trying to encourage people that we could be bold about limiting government size and scope and reach, some reduction we were talking about. I remember making the offhand comment, you'd be amazed how much government you'd never miss. And some wise ass reporter said, who do you think you are, Calvin Coolidge? I said, I'd like to be. Yes, I would. I've been asking myself, thinking ahead to tonight, you know, what would President Coolidge think of our current politics and the current national scene? I repaired to The shelf, it's a couple down from Amity's book, and it's that great little thing that the late Peter Hannaford, and we're going to miss him, did. I believe Peter did it, the quotable Coolidge. It's full of great aphorisms and things that he said, you know, quite, I'm sure, many of them very spontaneously. So if people are worried about gridlock, right, Congress can't do things, I'm pretty sure he would have said, as he once did, it's a lot more important to kill a bad bill than to pass a good one. Agree with that one? Surveying the current presidential field, really on both sides, I wrote it down. He once said, the political mind is the product of men twice spoiled, once by praise and once by abuse. Said, with them, nothing is natural, everything is artificial. He hadn't even met Donald Trump. Imagine this. And I can only, we can only imagine how boggled he'd be by the absurdity of our fiscal position. You know, we've, somebody earlier mentioned another great friend of mine, Chris DeMuth, had a great, great line recently. Some of you will have read. He said, we're suffering from deficit attention disorder. I mean, I guess after a point, you know, when nothing is done and the zeros keep accumulating, we all, I mean, we're prone to we get desensitized. I've often remarked that, so Sherry and I have four daughters, I've often remarked that happens when you have children, that when the first one caught a cold, we rushed her to the pediatrician. And when the fourth one swallowed a quarter, I took it out of her allowance. You can become a little too numb to these things, but I'm sure President Coolidge would not have done that. When I thought about it, I thought of a story that I sometimes favor. I think he would have responded just as the New England sea captain did when the young sailor asked him, what do you do, Captain, when you're caught in a gale force wind with a reef near a lee? And the captain said, what you do is you don't get yourself in that position. And don't we wish that someone, that President Coolidge had been around to operate on that principle when there was still time. Boy, could we use a Coolidge today. This needs no elaboration in this crowd. He knew and lived up to it that the vitality of a free society and of the America that was coming to be, and that he did so much to make the dominant country on the planet, comes from its liberation of the energies and talents of free men and women, from giving them the opportunity to create wealth for each other. And we live in a time when I sometimes have said that if we could assemble, if someone assembled a committee of Nobel laureates in economics and said, please come back with a plan to strangle the American economy, what combination of tax and regulatory and other policies would most likely choke off growth? It would look pretty much like what we've been doing for the last 7 or 8 years. And you know, this just has such profound implications. I mean, first for our immediate politics, Wendell and I were talking here at the table. I firmly believe that the understandable frustration and even anger of so many of our fellow citizens traces more than anything to economic apprehension. People who have known all their lives, or thought they did, that life would be better for their kids, that any setbacks in their own life could be overcome, when they're suddenly forced to question that. And does anybody here see it differently? the current economy is still a terribly weak and feeble one. I think I used to believe that the most misleading government data of all were the poverty numbers, and they are. They, I think, purposely so, because of all the things they don't count. But now I'm beginning to think the most misleading and misinterpreted numbers are the unemployment numbers, which are telling us less and less and less. Actually, fewer people are working, smaller percentages of people are working. Of the anemic recovery we've had, I think I'm right, David, still the weakest one ever from a recession that deep, the jobs that have happened, we now discover 90% of them are part-time and temporary. Is it any wonder that people are concerned? Calvin Coolidge would have known, not only is that economically foolish, it's enormously destructive of the optimism and the common commitment of a country that was never built on race, never built on tribe, never built on religious or ethnic unity, was always built around an idea, and that idea is being threatened. I'd love to believe that Americans have always been unified because they all read the Federalist Papers and thrilled to the principles in them, as so many of us do. But if we're honest, we know that what has attracted the millions to these shores, what has animated people, which has created enough unity in this country to get us through the rough spots, has been a sense of economic optimism and confidence, and that's been very severely shaken, and we have to get it back. And on the spending side of the equation, good grief, wouldn't it be nice to have somebody who said, as Coolidge did, my operating principles are economy, economy, and economy, who said things like, what the public has, the public must pay for. From this, there is no escape. People may believe we have escaped temporarily, that we can print money indefinitely, that we can mask the severity of our fiscal, of our debt situation by artificially jimmying down interest rates. But the chickens will be roosting soon. So I wasn't looking for applause in predicting economic catastrophe. I mean, but thank you. So yeah, we could use a Coolidge, but I've been trying to ask myself ever since Amity talked me into this, could we find one? And if we found her or him, could we elect one? And it's just an interesting thought experiment, and I'm not going to give you an answer because I can't fashion one myself. I'm only sure of this. If we find one, the next one probably won't come from New England, not the New England that I see today. Disraeli said the successful political leader must know himself and know the times. Amity wrote that President Coolidge, his ideas and the culture were in harmony. And I think she proves it in the book. Well, his ideas are probably not in harmony with this culture. I think his humility would serve him very well. We could use a little of that these days. But his humility, one thing I love about it was it led him to his abiding faith in the American people and in their ultimate good judgment, common sense, and anchor and their anchoring in the values that undergird freedom. I copied down this line also from the book. In time of crisis, my belief that people can know the truth, that when it is presented to them, they must accept it. They must accept it. That belief has saved me from the counsels of expediency, which I take to mean that he had sufficient trust in the American people to believe that he could do the hard things, he could do the difficult, he could do the temporarily unpopular, and that their long-term judgment would sustain him. Now, I've always thought that, too. In fact, I wrote a book just 3 years ago, and that was, with plenty of caveats, that was the central thesis of the book, that if we would trust Americans enough, first to run their own lives, decide with their own, you know, what mortgage they wanted, what credit card they wanted, what light bulb they wanted, where their child should go to school, all these things, what kind of health care they should have, that we could trust them with that, that this was the way, I sometimes say, that we should view people as creatures of dignity, not objects of therapy. And Coolidge, I think, felt that way. But the Coolidge we need, and who I hope will show himself or herself soon, will have a tall order, probably will not be fully in harmony with the culture of our time. We have encouraged and maybe seduced a lot of Americans into a very different notion of their own appropriate station and of the appropriate role of government in their lives. I was on C-SPAN for an hour last, Friday morning. And the subject was mainly about, it was supposed to be about higher ed. And, but then they go to the phone lines and you can get anything. And a lovely sounding, apparently older lady named Muriel called in from, I think it was New Hampshire, somewhere up there. And she just went off. I had said something about Social Security. And she just went off about the fact that, you know, she'd paid in all those years, and she had all the misunderstandings of how the system worked. And I hope politely explained to Muriel what the real facts are, and that the authors of Social Security and then its later progeny coined the term, the noble lie. The noble lie was to tell people, that's your money. You earned it, you paid it, even though you're going to get back six times what you put in, even though it was never your money, you were paying for the retirees of your day, and now some younger person's paying for you, all these things. And can you imagine Calvin Coolidge finding any lie to the American people noble? But Muriel is not only typical, it's not only a common view, it is the prevailing view, and a Coolidge of our time is going to have a heavy lift in explaining these fundamental facts to people, explaining to them that unwittingly they are plundering their young in a way that no society can successfully get away with for long. I think that President Coolidge would understand, I know he would understand, that what are sometimes looked at as fiscal issues are ultimately issues of character and questions of our capacity for self-government. This, after all, is the man who said that a good budget is a monument to virtue. There's a moral aspect, you know, this green, you know, people talk about green eye shades, well, okay, but there's a moral aspect to not spending money that you didn't earn or spending money that you didn't raise, or borrowing money and dumping the bills on those, spending it, by the way, not for investment in the future, but on current consumption for yourself and your own generation, and passing the bill on to younger people like the ones I spend all my time with these days. So in writing the book, I came across this interesting little nugget. In fact, it was Bruce Coles who got mentioned. Son Ryan, who did a little research with me on the book, who found this. On the early coinage of our country, on some of it was printed the Latin phrase, exitus in dubio est. The outcome remains in doubt. They understood at the founding of this country, this experiment of ours, is not the way of the world. It's not the natural order of things. The natural order of history is kings and tyrants and autocrats and militarists, and that they understood that there was a danger that, given the power, the consent of the governed, power, eventually people would spend themselves, would decide that they would realize they could appropriate the money of someone else, and they would spend themselves into bankruptcy. Or that they would, that the character traits which gave birth to freedom would wither. Calvin Coolidge certainly would have, he certainly understood that, he represented it, he embodied it, that's why one can wish for the reemergence of someone or some people with those traits today. Now, we could get another Coolidge in the way that many people have forecast for a long time. They say, well, you know, this system of ours, the Congress, the whole system, simply doesn't deal with things until they're up against the wall. Well, that'd be a very sad thing if that's the only way we can do it, because if we wait till we're against the wall, we'll have to do much more extreme and harsh things than if we were to begin acting even now when so much time has slipped by. British, 100 years ago, had a phrase I always liked, now that the money has run out, we shall have to begin to think. If we get to that point, I hope someone will be available who has done the thinking already, who will have the character of a Coolidge, the courage of a Coolidge, the clear understanding of what's at stake beyond the dollars and cents and the temporal decisions that government makes, what's at stake in terms of the character traits that are essential to a free people. And if we can't find a Coolidge in the flesh, then let us hope that programs like this great one that you are supporting, both the honoring the journalists like Tom Easton and these young scholars, I can't wait to see the young people who will emerge through that process. I hope we'll find a Coolidge, but if not, I hope we'll find some collection of people of the character and with the values he so uniquely personified. We just can't get there fast enough. Thank you very, very much.
One quick question, Governor, if you will, from Ravenel Curry. Ravenel, you have a question for the Governor?
What's the future of the Republican Party as you see it? Ravenel, first of all, I have to tell you or remind you, we're old friends, that when this latest unexpected assignment came to me, I told everyone that day I accepted that I was, you know, I would swear an oath of political celibacy, and I have subscribed to that. I'll try to give you a clinical answer because I really do, out of respect, really, for the institution that I serve, walk the middle of the balance beam. But I think, honestly, that a great opportunity is there. I think the natural rhythm of politics suggests that people will be looking, as they do every 8 years, to something different. The objective conditions in the country are not good. I talked a little bit about the economy and how weak I think it is, how fundamentally weak I think it is. When you ask the American people, are we on the right track or the wrong track, the numbers are 2-1 adverse. So I guess I'd say it this way. If you took the celebrity vote out of the picture, if you just imagine for a moment that the current front runner or maybe the top two were not there, the situation would look enormously promising, both at the executive and legislative branch. And you might imagine a situation where a different set of policies might actually be capable of enactment. But I've been as fooled as everybody else by the development so far, and haven't been wrong that up to this point. For all I know, that this situation will obtain a while longer. So I guess I'll finish this way. There was a time when I thought about pursuing national office, and I felt the single most important thing, if we had done such a fool thing, would be to campaign campaign to govern, not just to win, but to govern. There's just no sense in doing it unless you have a program and agenda you think will make this country safer, stronger, freer. And I can remember saying to a couple audiences, the second worst thing I could think of then, this is before my oath, would be a continuation of the policies as they were ongoing in 2012. But the worst thing would be to succeed and then not be able to do anything about it. And I just hope that those who are still on the field of combat will be thinking about that and will think carefully, as both presidents I served, certainly President Reagan, did all the time, about, you know, about how to actually achieve success and why 70% is better than zero if and when they do make it in what ought to be a very auspicious environment.
Thank you, Governor Daniels. I know many of us wish you might have run, but we respect your decision, and we thank you very much for your service and all the work you continue to do. Now, your desserts will be coming around in just one moment, but as has become tradition at our dinners, we often have a brief comment from Larry Kudlow on the importance of Coolidge, the importance of responsibility, and his thoughts. Larry.
I'm sort of the, I'm the optimist. I can't help myself. And things are, you know, not looking great, but they will be great. I believe that. I think Coolidge believed that. I want to pay homage to Amity, as Wendell Willkie did. I don't think she ever gets enough credit. And what she set up here is an educational foundation and a historical foundation. And it starts with her books, and now it goes through these great debates, and it's endless. And you never get enough credit, and we love you for that. And it's a wonderful thing. And here's the great part of this story. I'm going to get back to my optimism. Actually, Amity makes me optimistic. So does Seth, sometimes. So Amity writes this great book and sets up this great foundation in what is really a very dreary period. All right? That's how we will look back on this. It's not the end of the world. America will recover. It always does. Greatest nation in the world, and freedom will do it. But Amity sets up this fabulous thing, eulogizing, lauding, and discussing Coolidge, an unlikely hero, unless you knew him and knew what he stood for. And she does it during a dreary period, which, Amity, is exactly when we needed it most. So thank you. So, just a couple things. It's a great pleasure to be back here. I was reading the little handout book, and Coolidge on Prosperity. Let me just make this, I'm going to precede this, but Coolidge says, prosperity is the product of spiritual resources. Okay, that's in the book, in your little handout. Prosperity is the product of spiritual resources. I just love that. I just love that. Prosperity is not a bad thing, it's a good thing. Capitalism is not a bad thing, it's a good thing. Free markets aren't bad things, they're good things. You know, there's a study out, I think from the World Bank, not exactly a right-wing institution. In the last three decades with the rise of free trade and free markets, 80% of the dollar a day abject poverty has been solved in the, around the world. 80% in three decades. The middle class has expanded by nearly 1 billion people due to the onset of free trade and free markets, and I don't care what the Chinese call it, it's capitalism. Okay, I hope they stay with it. So here's Coolidge saying prosperity is a product of spiritual resources. It doesn't get any better than that. I'm not going to go into politics. You've got people on the campaign trail saying really dumb things. All right, I'm going to save capitalism from itself. Huh? What? I'm going to save you from yourself. That's the way I look at that. You know who I'm talking about, not Governor Daniels for sure. And you know, somebody else wants to, you know, go back to 90% tax rates. And as Mitch suggested in his diplomatic way, which is why I love him, there's some weird stuff going on the other side too. So I'm not here to play those cards. I'm just here to raise these points. Coolidge's life, so far as I know, and from reading Amity's book and my own travels, by the way, my hometown was the hometown of Coolidge's best friend, Dwight Morrow, in Englewood, New Jersey. So I know a little bit about the story. Coolidge was fundamentally a virtuous man. That's what I'm getting to. So when he says prosperity is a product of a spiritual, he was fundamentally a virtuous man. That's what he saw. And he believed, correctly in my opinion, that less government was a virtue, lower taxing was a virtue, and more economic freedom was a virtue. That's why it's so important that we talk about this. And we talk about Coolidge. I want to add to that list, you know. I want to say to people anywhere, work is a virtue. Work is a virtue. Saving is a virtue. Investing is a virtue. Entrepreneurship is a virtue. You know why? Because when you do it right and let the system work, you help other people. You help them. You don't hurt them. I don't want to save capitalism from itself. I want to let capitalism roar. Roar. Because we all do better and we help other people. So, you know, the idea of a virtue, I'm going to take it a step further. I'm hopeless and shameless. I think work is a godly virtue. I think saving is a godly virtue. I think building a great economy is a godly virtue. I think literally when we help other people do better and prosper, we are acting in the name of the Lord, and it's just that simple. It is a virtue. So I'll just summarize. Freedom is a virtue. Family is a virtue. Why is this so hard? Faith is a virtue. The pursuit of life, liberty, and happiness, endowed by our Creator, life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. It's just not a coincidence that that's there, and Coolidge picked up on it, and the great presidents always do. Amity's sending me a quote from Warren Harding. You got me, I didn't see it. I'm finishing up a book on the JFK tax cuts. If JFK were alive today, he'd been a Reagan Republican. And Amity sent me a book of Warren Harding, essentially something that Kennedy said, you know, ask not what you can do for your country, but what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. And there's Warren Harding. I'm thinking, yeah, continuity. And Coolidge felt the same way. And then it got interrupted for a while. And then we got back on track. And then it got interrupted for a while. And then we got back on track. And right now it's been interrupted for a while, but we'll get back on track. We will. It's in our heart, and it's in our soul, and it is a virtue. And that's what Coolidge teaches us. And that's why it is so important to keep up this good work. That's all I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. I'm not sure anywhere in America you could hear two speeches like that back and back to back. Mitch Daniels, Larry Kudlow, thank you very much to both of you. Now we'll keep moving. Your desserts are coming around. I know that I owe you guys an answer. Who won the debate? I'll say that the room at the beginning tilted a bit towards the negative, but after a very wonderful debate, the outcome came in favor of the affirmative. So this room moved more towards the affirmative than towards the negative. Congratulations to both debate teams. Thank you. At the Coolidge Foundation, we give two major journalism prizes. We give one to youth for youth writing in the state of Vermont, and we give another one to national level writers who publish in newspapers and blogs and around the country. First, tonight we'll present our Calvin Prize for Vermont Youth, and please join me in welcoming my colleague, our program associate, Rashad Thomas, and the vice chair of the Coolidge Foundation's board, Catherine Nelson, who will present the award.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Calvin Coolidge was born on the 4th of July in 1872 in the rural hamlet of Plymouth Notch, Vermont. Although Coolidge pursued his career in Massachusetts and in Washington, Vermont always held a special place in his heart. The Calvin Prize for Vermont Youth therefore celebrates President Coolidge's Vermont heritage by honoring the youth who are the future of the Green Mountain State. The prize elevates their voices and gives them a platform to express their hopes and fears for the people President Coolidge called, and I quote, "a race of pioneers who have almost beggared themselves to serve others," unquote. Over the Calvin Prize's three-year history, hundreds of young Vermonters have submitted original writing to the contest. The prize awards $1,500 to the first place winner and $500 to the runner-up.
I'm going to use his, it's big type. This year's contest asks students a timely question and one that relates to our scholarship. The question, whether they believe higher education is worth the cost to them and their families. Students describe the factors that influenced their decision, weighing the cost and benefits of college given the substantial debt that many students must bear to obtain a four-year degree. The students referred to letters a young Calvin Coolidge wrote to his father regarding the costs associated with attendance at Amherst College, which totaled 300 in the 1890s, or the equivalent of around 8,000 today. Other letters from Coolidge to his father discussed the possibility of law school, but the high cost of law school was one reason Coolidge didn't attend law school. Instead, he became a lawyer by reading the law. After reviewing the submissions, the foundation staff forwarded the essays of 10 semifinalists to our distinguished panel of judges for consideration. The Calvin Prize jury then selected two finalists, both whom join us here this evening. You can read their prize entries in your dinner program. Before announcing the finalists and results, we'd like to thank our prize jury. Several of our jurors are here with us tonight. I'll read the names of the jury and ask those who are joining us here tonight to stand when I read your name. David Petrusa, Jim Cook, Kate Bradley, Jennifer Sales Harville, John Dumville, Diane Kimball, and Rashad. I will now read the finalists' names in alphabetical order and ask that they stand for your applause. Catherine Bessette and Ethan Forster. Bravo, bravo. Oh, here they are. And now to unveil the results. On behalf of the Coolidge family and the Calvin Coolidge Presidential Foundation, we are pleased to announce the runner-up for this year's Calvin Prize is Catherine Bessette of Heartland, Vermont. Catherine, please join us on the stage. Finally, it is my pleasure to announce the winner of the 2015 Calvin Prize for Vermont Youth, Ethan Forster of Danville, Vermont. Thank you.
Thank you, and congratulations again. We received so many wonderful essays from our Calvin Prize, and congratulations to both of you. It's now my pleasure to introduce the folks who will announce our big $20,000 Coolidge Prize for Journalism. Talking a bit about the award and presenting it tonight, please join me in welcoming the great-grandson of President Coolidge, Chris Coolidge Jeter, and Chairman of the National Notary Association, Milt Valera.
Good evening. It's great to have you all gathered here tonight and have such a good attendance for a third year in a row of doing this dinner in New York. And my great-grandfather, Calvin Coolidge, had a tremendous respect for the free press in our society. During his time in the White House, he gave over 500 in-person press conferences and made himself personally available to the media more than any other president before or after. Coolidge cared about finance, but he cared about freedom more. He once said, "I could not truly criticize the vast importance of the counting room, but my ultimate faith I would place in the high idealism of the editorial room of the American newspaper." After he left the White House, he became a member of the press himself, writing a syndicated newspaper column titled "Calvin Coolidge Says," which ran throughout the country from 1930 to 1931. It is in that spirit that tonight the Calvin Coolidge Foundation presents the third annual Coolidge Prize for Journalism.
Thank you, Chris. My name is Milt Valera. I'm a trustee on the board of for the foundation of Calvin Coolidge. Before I start, I want to say thank you to many people, but first of all, Amity Shlaes, because all of this would not be possible without Amity. So what about a big hand for Amity? Now, another thing I've noticed is that these things were all on your seats, but nobody's opened them. And everybody's looking around and saying, what are we supposed to do with this? Well, I'll start. You pull the tab here and rip it open and then see what's inside. There's a book here, a very, very special book. And it's called Why Coolidge Matters. I'll leave it at that, but I would ask you all that to take a look at this book. It's very, very important because this is a bipartisan book. You'd be surprised about some of the people who are writing in this book. The Coolidge Prize for Journalism is awarded to the author who best captures the spirit and style of the 30th president and the ideals and values he favored. The prize especially seeks to find and reward writers whose work promoting Coolidge values deserves credit, greater recognition. More than 80 recipients sent in articles for consideration from all over the country, I might add. Submitted works came from blogs, internet news outlets, and traditional print media. In the spirit of Calvin Coolidge, who said in 1915, above all things, be brief. Each article had an 800-word limit, so maybe 802, 803. The Coolidge Foundation assembled a wonderful jury for this year's prize, and I had the honor to chair the jury. So I'll read the names of the members of the jury and ask that those present here at the dinner stand when their name is called. Tom Easton. Peggy Noonan. Steve Forbes, Wes Mann, Don Boudreau, Holman Jenkins, Matthew Denhart, Cal Thomas, John Temney, and Catherine Nelson. Thank you all for participating in this important endeavor. And of course, heading all of this, we can't forget her, Amity Shlaes. We'd like to now recognize our top three finishers. Top three out of 80 throughout the country. They include, in no particular order, Steve Fryeth, Steve Jacoby, and James Otteson. Now, this is a very important prize, very important prize. You can find selections from our finalists included in your dinner program. It is now my pleasure to announce that the runner-up for this year's Coolidge Prize for Journalism, the runner-up, is James Otteson. The prize jury was particularly pleased to read Mr. Otteson's columns making an eloquent appeal to the inherent moral value of capitalism and commerce. Thank you for being up there. Thank you. Thank you.
And now, the moment you've all been waiting for, we are pleased to announce that the winner of the 2015 Coolidge Prize for Journalism is Stephen Fryeth. I'll just quickly add that from Stephen's home base in Rhode Island, Mr. Fryeth penned a series of columns on classic Coolidge themes: the folly of excessive taxation, the need to honestly account for the public debt, and the challenge that public sector unions sometimes pose. Congratulations, Mr. Fryeth.
To say that I'm honored and thrilled is an understatement. I'll start out with that. This is a great, great award and a great honor for me. I'm an attorney by my profession, so every day I spend writing. But what I enjoy writing the most, what I find most rewarding, is writing about history, politics, economics from a limited government perspective. Limited government is the kind of principles that many of our great American leaders have held, have promoted, and believed. And one of those great American leaders, of course, we're honoring tonight in Calvin Coolidge. The principles that Calvin Coolidge espoused, promoted decades ago, still resonate, they're still relevant, and they still matter today. And they inspire us. He certainly inspired me in my column writing. I'll tell you, in my home state of Rhode Island, public sector unions are kind of powerful. And when one public sector union leader, a police union leader, kind of got out of hand and upset when his police contract was rejected, he started engaging some bad behavior in my home state, some intimidation tactics. And when I wrote my column denouncing that behavior, the words that inspired me and are reflected in that column were the words that Calvin Coolidge used almost a century ago in the Boston police strike about there's no strike against the public safety anywhere, anytime. As long as there are people who believe in limited government principles and those kinds of ideals, I believe the spirit of Calvin Coolidge is alive and well and with us today. So thank you very, very much for this. I don't know what else to say. Thanks.
Congratulations, Stephen. Congratulations, Jim. It was quite the competition, and we're so pleased to help spread Coolidge through the media through this prize. And thank you, Tom Smith and Diane Smith, for supporting it. Well, what a night we've had. We thank all of you for being here. We especially want to thank, again, our major sponsors, Tom and Diane Smith, the National Notary Foundation, Bob Luddy, John Childs, David and Caroline Johnson, Nancy Lazar and Cornerstone Macro, and Jennifer Foster and Graham Foster. Thanks to all of our individual sponsors, too. Thank you especially to the Women's Republican Club and its president, Robin Weaver, and to the staff. How about a hand for the staff? Now, I can't let you go without reminding you about the red envelopes that Amity told you about. We are undertaking a major, major new project that has all of us very excited, the Coolidge Scholars Program. We have the initial funding in place, but we really do need more support to pull off a world-class program. Our website launched today, our application will open on November 2nd, and we can really use all the help you can give us. So if you find that tonight, on your way out, you'd like to make a gift, we would love if you would leave it in the red envelope and give it to Jen Buxton on your way out. Jen will stand up. She's wearing the blue dress. And thank you. But most of all, we want to say thank you. We're going to close here real soon. But we want you to continue the party when we're done. The bar will be open in the entranceway until 11 p.m. So you and your guests are welcome to stay and continue to party, you know, most of the night, if you feel like it. But before the partying really gets into full gear, there is no better speech to remind us of really why we're here than a speech that President Coolidge gave in 1914 when he was accepting his election as president of the Massachusetts State Senate. That speech, and we're losing our sign, thanks, nice catch, Jim, was called Have Faith in Massachusetts. So we're going to close tonight's dinner, I think very appropriately, hearing those words. And we have a wonderful orator in our own midst, my colleague and friend, Rashad Thomas, who will come and recite Have Faith in Massachusetts. Rashad.
Honorable senators, I thank you with gratitude for the high honor given, with appreciation for the solemn obligations assumed, I thank you. The Commonwealth is one. We are all members of one body. The welfare of the weakest and the welfare of the most powerful are inseparably bound together. Industry cannot flourish if labor languish. Transportation cannot prosper if manufacturers decline. The general welfare cannot be provided for in any one act, but it is well to remember that the benefit of one is the benefit of all, and the neglect of one is the neglect of all. The suspension of one man's dividends is the suspension of another man's pay envelope. Men do not make laws, they do but discover them. Laws must be justified by something more than the will of the majority. They must rest on the eternal foundations of righteousness. That state is most fortunate in its form of government, which has the aptest instruments for the discovery of laws. The latest, most modern, and nearest perfect system that statesmanship has devised is representative government. Its weakness is the weakness of us imperfect human beings who administer it. Its strength is that even such administration secures to the people more blessings than any other system ever produced. No nation has discarded it and retained liberty. Representative government must be preserved. Courts are established not to determine the popularity of a cause, but to adjudicate and enforce rights. No litigant,
should be required to submit his case to the hazard and expense of a political campaign. No judge should be required to seek or receive political rewards. The courts of Massachusetts are known and honored wherever men love justice. Let their glory suffer no diminution at our hands. The electorate and the judiciary cannot combine. A hearing means a hearing. When the trial of causes goes outside the courtroom, Anglo-Saxon constitutional government ends. The people cannot look to legislation generally for success. Industry, thrift, character are not conferred by act or resolve. Government cannot relieve from toil. It can provide no substitute for the rewards of service. It can, of course, care for the defective and recognize distinguished merit. The normal must care for themselves. Self-government means self-support. Man is born into the universe with a personality that is his own. He has a right that is founded upon the constitution of the universe to have property that is his own. Ultimately, property rights and personal rights are the same thing. The one cannot be preserved if the other be violated. Each man is entitled to his rights and the rewards of his service, be they never so large or never so small. History reveals no civilized people among whom there was not a highly educated class, and large aggregations of wealth, represented usually by the clergy and the nobility. Inspiration has always come from above. Diffusion of learning has come down from the university to the common school. The kindergarten is last. No one would now expect to aid the common school by abolishing higher education. It may be that the diffusion of wealth works in an analogous way. As the little red schoolhouse is builded in the college, it may be that the fostering and protection of large aggregations of wealth are the only foundation on which to build the prosperity of the whole people. Large profits mean large payrolls. But profits must not be the result of service performed. In no land are there so many and such large aggregations of wealth as here. In no land do they perform larger service. In no land will the work of a day bring so large a reward in material and spiritual welfare. Have faith in Massachusetts. In some unimportant detail, some other states may surpass her. But in the general results, there is no place on earth where the people secure, in a larger measure, the blessings of organized government. And nowhere can those functions more properly be termed self-government. Do the day's work. If it be to protect the rights of the weak, whoever objects, do it. If it be to help a powerful corporation better to serve the people, whatever the opposition, do that. Expect to be called a stand-patter, but don't be a stand-patter. Expect to be called a demagogue, but don't be a demagogue. Don't hesitate to be as revolutionary as science. Don't hesitate to be as reactionary as the multiplication table. Don't expect to build up the weak by pulling down the strong. Don't hurry to legislate. Give administration a chance to catch up with legislation. We need a broader, firmer, deeper faith in the people, a faith that men desire to do right, that the Commonwealth is founded upon a righteousness which will endure, a reconstructed faith that the final approval of the people is given not to demagogues, slavishly pandering to their selfishness, merchandising with the clamor of the hour, but to statesmen, ministering to their welfare, representing their deep, silent, abiding convictions. Statutes must appeal to more than material welfare. Wages won't satisfy, be they never so large, nor houses, nor land, nor coupons, though they fall thick as the leaves of autumn. Man has a spiritual nature. Touch it, and it must respond as the magnet responds to the pole. To that, not to selfishness, let the laws of the Commonwealth appeal. Recognize the immortal worth and dignity of man. Let the laws of Massachusetts proclaim to her humblest citizens, performing the most menial task, the recognition of his manhood, the recognition that all men are peers, the humblest with the most exalted, the recognition that all work is glorified. Such is the path to equality before the law. Such is the foundation of liberty under the law. Such is the sublime revelation of man's relation to man, democracy.
Thank you very much.
That'll do it. Good night. Thank you for joining us for the third annual Coolidge Dinner. We hope to see you this summer in Plymouth Notch to judge the debate again, and we hope to see you back here next fall, the fourth annual Coolidge Dinner. Thank you. Good night.